Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to our devotion on this Wednesday of the third week of Lent. Our readings for today, this morning's devotion, are Jeremiah chapter 8, beginning at verse 18 and unto chapter 9, verse 6. The Gospel of John, chapter 8, beginning at verse 12 and unto 20. The psalm is number 119, verses 97 to 120. The collect is for the third Sunday in Lent. Please join us in our opening hymn.
The light of your love is shining in the midst.
Our service continues with the opening sentence for Lent on page 33 of your Book of Common Prayer, and then continuing on page 35. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the Lord, O God, by whose grace you are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. We continue in prayer. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer your worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. The Jubilate. O shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Come into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. His loving mercy is forever. His faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And now we approach God's throne of mercy, seeking his forgiveness for those things that we may have done that are not pleasing to him. Bringing to him even those things for which our consciences are afraid. Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown. Things done and left undone, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life, which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The psalm appointed for this morning, Psalm 119, verses 97 to 120. Psalm 119, verse 97. Oh, how I love your law! All day long it is in my mind. Your commandments have made me wiser than my enemies, and it is always with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for your decrees are my study. I'm wiser than the elders, because I observe your commandments. I restrain my feet from every evil way, that I may keep your word. I do not shrink from your judgment, because you yourself have taught me. How sweet are your words to my taste! They are sweeter than honey in my mouth. Through your commandments I gain understanding, therefore I hate every lying way. Your word is a lantern to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn and am determined to keep your righteous judgments. I am deeply troubled. Preserve my life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept, O Lord, the willing tribute of my lips, and teach me your judgments. My life is always in my hand, yet I do not forget your law. The wicked have set a trap for me, but I have not strayed from your commandments. Your decrees are my inheritance forever. Truly, they are the joy of my heart. I have applied my heart to fulfill your statutes, forever and to the end. I hate those who have divided hearts, but your law do I love. You are my refuge and shield. My hope is in your word. Away from me, you wicked, I will keep the commandments of my God. Sustain me according to your promise, that I may live, and let me not be disappointed in my hope. Hold me up, and I shall be safe, and my delight shall be ever in your statutes. You spurn all who stray from your statutes. Their deceitfulness is in vain. In your sight, all the wicked of the earth are but dross. Therefore, I love your decrees. My flesh trembles with dread of you. I'm afraid of your judgments. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. We continue with the first reading. Reading from the Old Testament. A reading from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 8, beginning at verse 18 and on to chapter 9, verse 6. My joy is gone, grief is upon me. My heart is sick. Hark the cry of my poor people from far and wide in the land. Is the Lord not in Zion? Is her king not in her? Why have they provoked me to anger with their images, with their foreign gods? The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. For the hurt of my poor people, I am hurt. I mourn, and dismay has taken hold of me. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then has the health of my poor people not been restored? Would that my head were a spring of water, and my eyes a fountain of tears, so that I may weep day and night for the slain of my poor people. Would that I had in the desert a traveler's lodging place, that I may leave my people and go away from them. For they are all adulterers, a band of traitors. They bend their tongue like bows. They have grown strong in the land for falsehood and not for truth. For they proceed from evil to evil, and they do not know me, says the Lord. Beware of your neighbors, and put no trust in any of your kin. For all your kin are supplanters, and every neighbor goes around like a slanderer. They all deceive their neighbors, and no one speaks the truth. They have taught their tongues to speak lies. They commit iniquity and are too wary to repent. Oppression upon oppression. Deceit upon deceit. They refuse to know me, says the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And so we continue now with the Benedictus. Benedictus, found on page 40 of your Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord God of Israel. You have come to your people and set them free. You have raised up for us a mighty Savior, born of the house of your servant David. Through your holy prophets, you promise of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our forebears, and to remember your holy covenant. This was the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship you without fear, holy and righteous before you, all the days of our life. And you, child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare the way, to give God's people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine upon those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. We continue now with a reading from the Holy Gospel. Gospel of John. A reading from the Holy Gospel of John, chapter 8, beginning at verse 12 and on to 20. John 8, 12 to 20. Again, Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Then the Pharisees said to him, You are testifying on your own behalf. Your testimony is not valid. Jesus answered, Even if I testify on my own behalf, my testimony is valid, because I know where I have come from and where I am going. But you do not know where I come from or where I am going. You judge by human standards. I judge no one. Yet even if I do judge, my judgment is valid. For it is not I alone who judge, but I and the Father who sent me. In your law it is written that the testimony of two witnesses is valid. I testify on my own behalf, and the Father who sent me testifies on my behalf. Then they said to him, Where is your Father? Jesus answered, You know neither me nor my Father. If you knew me, you would know my Father. He spoke these words while he was teaching in the treasury of the temple. But no one arrested him because his hour had not yet come. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. so, my brothers and sisters, I thank you very much for this privilege to share my thoughts with you on this morning's gospel reading. I do so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus, the light of the world. Now, Jesus was in the temple of Jerusalem. It was evening time, around the time of the festival of the booths. The New Oxford Annotated Bible records that the great golden lanterns in the temple were lit during the festival of the booths. This must have been at least a very noticeable sight. And Jesus may have used the light as a point of reference as he addressed those gathered. He spoke to them saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." This statement made over 2,000 years ago is true even today. For Jesus is the only true light of the world. In this world so darkened by sin, Jesus has proven himself to be the only true light. In the very beginning, in creation, he was part of the creation of the light of the world, a world that was formless, void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. The Gospel of John tells us that he was in the beginning and God with God. All things came into being through him. What has come into being in him was life. And the life was the light of all the people. The light shone in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There's no darkness which could ever overcome the light of Jesus. And if you feel any darkness in your life, my dear friends, turn to Jesus and allow his light to shine into your life and dispel any form of darkness that is in your life. There's no darkness that could be repel the light of Jesus. Apart from Jesus, there's no deliverance from the darkness of sin. He alone guides us to eternal life. No one but him could have promised that any... Sorry. He alone guides us to eternal life. No one but him could have promised that anyone who follows him would not walk in darkness, but will have eternal life. This light is not to be confused with that of day and night. But this light and this darkness is the light which shines into the darkness of the hearts of men. The only light of his teaching. It is only the light of his teaching can repel the darkness in the hearts of men. And his invitation to follow him is not a suggestion that one should try to live exactly like him, for no one really can. But we could pattern ourselves, we could pattern our life from the way he lived, so that we could repel every hint of darkness in our lives. Following Christ means to turn to him in repentance, trusting in him as Lord and Savior, then committing our lives to him. This is how we would walk away from the darkness, but had the light of his life in our life. Now the Pharisees were always ever ready to pounce on Jesus' every word. They were always endeavoring to change his truth into whatever contrary, degenerative meaning they could fabricate And here we see them true to form, trying to mount some legal challenge to Jesus' statement that Jesus had testified unto him for himself, and that Jesus testified on his own behalf, and that his testimony was not valid. It was not legal for a person to testify on their own behalf. Testimony concerning oneself was not valid, and it may not even be valid today. And they claim it is not proof enough because of self-bias. And the Pharisees did not only doubt what Jesus said, but they convinced themselves that what he said was not true. The Pharisees did not only not believe what he said, but they tried to put a spin on it to convince others that what he said is not true. But Jesus knew the law concerning witnesses and the support of testimony. In his case, his witness was God and the Holy Spirit. For the tree comprised, and himself, the tree comprised the Godhead, and are one in being. At the baptism, the Father's testimony about his Son was revealed by the Holy Spirit for all to see. There can be no witness as true as God. And Jesus is the Son of God. So Jesus replied to them, saying that he knew where he came from and where he was going. But they did not know where he came from or where he was going. Jesus knew he came from the Father. He came from heaven. And that he would return to him. He would return there in heaven to him on completion of his Father's work. The Pharisees thought Jesus to be just another ordinary person and refused to believe that he was the Son of God. Even in the face of the miracles that he performed, even in the face of the Old Testament prophecy which they knew, even in the face of all that he did, they bluntly refused to accept Jesus to be the Son of God. I trust that none of you who are hearing my voice do not believe as the Pharisees did. I trust that we all believe that Jesus is the Son of God. We learn in Philippians 2 that Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited. Indeed, Jesus never uses divine power to force himself on anyone. Instead, Jesus used his teaching and the revelations of the good news to lead mankind unto the Father and to cause those who believe, who heard, to follow him. But the Pharisees never accepted his teaching and look only at his outward appearance, judging him by their standards. And even so, Jesus explained that he judged no one. And this meant that his purpose of coming into the world was not really to judge, but to save. And in any case, it is not he alone who judged, but he and the Father. Jesus continued explaining that he had the authority to judge and did so jointly with his Father who sent him and who testified on his behalf and validated his testimony he made concerning himself. So according to their written laws, his testimony is valid, and the support required for his testimony was in place. Jesus acknowledged that the law of Moses stipulated that two witnesses are necessary for the validation of a testimony. If they insisted on two witnesses, then his sinless life and the Father's validation from heaven is sufficient to meet the requirements of the law of Moses. They have their two witnesses. The lesson here for us, my friends, is that in this life, there will always be those who will try to damage your image once you are working for Christ. Sometimes they try to damage your image to build up their own. Jesus teaches that we must always allow our good works, conduct, and the way we live in general to testify as to who we really are. And the validation will come from above in due course. We must all pray for strength to do this. Jesus now goes further in making his point more direct and unambiguous. He said to the Pharisees, "I testify on my own behalf, and the Father who sent me testifies on my own behalf." The statement verifies the fact that the Father testified concerning Jesus on more than one occasion. We can call to mind at his conception, Luke 1, 31 to 32. At his baptism, Luke 3, 21. And at his transfiguration, Luke 9, 36. At his conception, the angel testified that the child would be great and called the Son of the Most High. At his baptism and transfiguration, God himself testified that Jesus is his Son. Jesus emphatically fulfilled the prophecies of the Old Testament concerning the expectant Messiah. It was evident that based on all which he did, that he was in fact the Messiah. Yet the Pharisees blatantly refused to accept the evidence. So glowingly presented to them. And on numerous occasions, they always tried to refute whatever he said. And so, the Pharisees stubbornly refused to believe. Fortunately for us, we have the evidence, we have the proof of his life, and we have so many things to prove that Jesus is the Son of God. To the next question, Jesus responded concerning his parentage. They had said to him, "Where is your father?" A question which challenged his knowledge of his identity, of his own father. But Jesus was quick to respond, saying that they had no knowledge of him or his father. For if they knew him, they had been aware that he and the Father are one, and that he embodied the will of the Father, which is to lead everyone to him. Accordingly, according to the reading, the treasury of the building was identified at the place of this encounter. Now, this is important because research revealed that in the treasury, only the priests were allowed. This meant that this conversation that Jesus was having and was forced to argue his validity and to challenge his lineage, it was in the presence of supposedly the most enlightened religious sect. They should have been knowledgeable of the Old Testament, which pointed to the Christ on account of all of which he was engaged in. But because of the hardness of their heart and disagreement against the truth, they harbored thoughts of wanting to arrest Jesus. And as if to confirm his sovereignty, Jesus seemed to be surrounded by some divine protection, which prevented them from arresting him. Jesus had much more to do, and his time had not yet come. so they could not have arrested him, although they wanted to. Jesus had so much to do that, and the time for his ultimate sacrifice was still yet to come. My friends, Matthew Henry postulates that we become vain in our imaginations concerning God, that those who become vain in their imagination concerning God will never know Christ. Those who knew not his glory and grace knew not the Father who sent him. They will remain in their darkness, in the darkness of their vain imaginations, and will not see the light of the world. What a sad position for anyone to be in. So we are called to readily get to know Jesus Christ, not only as the light of the world, but also as our own personal Savior. In so doing, we come to better know the Father who sent him. John 14:6 says, Jesus told us, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Pharisees had professed to know God, but they refused to accept his Son. In so doing, they cut off their own path to the Father. So let us then follow the light of Christ, the only way to the Father who sent him, so that on the day he will welcome us into his kingdom, simply because we follow the light. The Lord be with you.
Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my
continue now in prayer as we confess our faith, as we say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial. Deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So by way of intercession, we continue to pray for a world so divided and torn apart by wars, simply because of the hardness of the hearts of men towards each other. But we pray, hopefully, that the hearts of men would soften towards each other. In spite of all the turmoil, we pray that the wars will cease and that peace will increase. Lord, in your mercy, please hear our prayer. We pray for the victims of all the natural disasters in the world, the earthquakes, the floods, the mudslides. We pray for the families of the victims, that they will be comforted. And we pray that those who have died will find rest. Lord, in your mercy, please hear our prayer. We continue to pray for the Anglican Church worldwide, for its leader, the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Most Reverend Justin Welby. We pray for our provincial Archbishop, the Most Reverend Howard Gregory. We pray for our own Bishop, the Right Reverend Claude Berkeley, thanking God for giving him the strength to face his ordeals and to continue his good work in this diocese. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the retired bishops, Calvin, Roland, Clive. For the goodness of and the grace of God in their latter years. In our own diocese, today we pray for St. Patrick's, Mount Pleasant, Tobago, the Reverend Father Jean-Paul Henry, the Reverend Helen Nathan, and we pray for the diocesan retreat movement. In our own parish in St. Mary's, we continue to pray for our parish priest, the Reverend Father Dr. Anders Maxwell, for God's blessing on him and on those who assist, Reverend Father Titus Akbarali. We pray for him especially because of his ongoing health challenges. We pray for Reverend Presbyter Pontifex Andre, the deacons Reverend Mark Haynes, and Rodwin Fanfare, that God will bless them all to continue his good work. Also for the laity, remembering the groups in the parish that continue to support this parish so wholeheartedly. We pray also for former rector, Canon Jemmett Hazelwood. I pray that God will continue to bless him, that he will be able to enjoy his golden days. We bring before God the congregations in our parish and the Rupun that we are trying to build, St. Philip's Lopino, the Church of the Transfiguration, St. Aidan's, St. Mary's, and Maloney, St. Maloney. We pray that God will continue to bless us as we try to go forward and build these congregations. We pray for those who are sick, that they should remember that they are not alone, and they should use this very special time to draw closer to God. We pray for those who have passed in the hope that God will grant them his rest, and we continue in prayer with Suffrage A. O Lord, reveal your love among us, that we may know the joy of your salvation. Grant peace within and among all nations, and teach our leaders wisdom. Endow your church with faithfulness, and your servants with knowledge and true godliness. Defend, O Lord, the rights of the poor and the oppressed, that your justice may be known among all people. Lord, renew your spirit within us, that innocent through us, your will may be done. Our collect is for the third Sunday in Lent, found on page 164. Let us pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to us, happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Our collect is for the third Sunday in Lent. We pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil through which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Error. Our collect is for the third Sunday in Lent. Let us pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all even thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We turn to page 45. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves this day. Let your presence be with us this close. Strengthen us to remember that the wonderful good works we do, we are serving you. Give us a diligent and watchful spirit, that we may seek in everything to know your will, and knowing it, may gladly perform it to the honor and glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The prayer of dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our path, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit. And in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us evermore. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now, my dear brothers and sisters, our service has come to an end for this morning. I trust that someone was edified. Let us now go in peace and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.